This video is part of the Living Lab lecture series, and we are going to talk about abstract argumentation frameworks. Let us start with an illustrating example. Suppose you are at a very exciting party. And at some point, we are trying to figure out what we are going to eat today. As usual, one of the first suggestions is we could order pizza. Now, we want to keep track of the discussion, and this is why we note here that the first argument was for pizza. Now, pizza is a very good idea because many people in the room like cheese, and you can order pizza with as much cheese as you want, and we also write this down here. However, not everybody likes pizza all the time, and this is why another suggestion comes into play, namely, we could also order Taiwanese food. Since Taiwanese food usually does not come with so much cheese, there is an attack from Taiwanese food to the cheese, which we denote here by this arrow. So we could now, of course, say, all right, this is no problem. We can order both pizza and Taiwanese food, and then everybody is happy. However, there is a problem because there is also delivery charge. And since we do not want to pay delivery charge twice, we have to make a decision on whether to order Taiwanese food or pizza. That's why there is a mutual attack here between pizza and Taiwanese, showing that we have to decide for either one of them. Now, there is also another idea, namely we could cook at home. This could be fun, a nice social event, so why not? We do not have to order all the time. This would then, of course, mean that we order neither pizza nor Taiwanese food. However, then somebody checks out the kitchen and realizes, maybe this is not such a good idea after all. Let us just stick with ordering food. And so we have finally this order food argument here, which then is a mutual attack relation with cooking at home, because again, this is a decision, an exclusive decision between cooking at home and ordering food. Now the discussion goes on, and we are going to make a break here, because after a couple of hours, it's getting really complicated and starts to look something like this. And we would like to have some tool, some automated machine or something like this to keep track of all the arguments for us so that everything is sorted out for us. And this is where artificial intelligence comes into play. And indeed, with modern AI techniques, we just need some data and a lot of computational power, and then we are good to go and can solve pretty much any conceivable problem, right? So, and since our society becomes more and more digital and our computers become better and better, we can use machine learning techniques, in particular artificial neural networks, to their fullest extent. However, there are also some drawbacks, and one of them, which is quite well known in modern AI research, is the lack of explainability. And what this means is that while machine learning techniques are quite good at teaching machines making the right decision, they are actually quite bad at teaching machines explaining their decision. And the reason is pretty much because machine learning techniques rely on statistics. And this is where knowledge representation and reasoning comes into play, because knowledge representation and reasoning tries to teach machines semantics, like our common sense reasoning. So we talk about knowledge representation and reasoning. Then we talk about abstract argumentation frameworks, in particular our current research and how it can contribute to explainability. And finally, we show how our research links to our Living Lab demonstrator. So let's start with knowledge representation and reasoning. As already mentioned, knowledge representation and reasoning aims at teaching machines semantic or common sense reasoning. And the tools we are going to use are various logics and formalisms. So why do we need these tools? Well, we need a way to express our knowledge in a way that machines can understand it. Now you could say, all right, this is easy. We have tools like this. These are just programming languages, right? And yes, this is true to some extent. There's an abundance of programming languages, for example, for web development, data analysis, machine learning, and more we might have heard of, and probably a lot more we have never heard of. However, these programming languages are very generic. Remember our initial example with the pizza discussion? This is a very specific situation. So we want to just analyze a discussion with our tool. Yeah? So what we are looking for is for a specific problem, an efficient representation language, which then gives us fast and tailored solutions, tailored for our needs. So what could such a knowledge representation formalism look like? Yeah, you probably guessed it already, an argumentation framework is such a formalism. So why do we choose argumentation frameworks to represent our discussion? Well, because it is intuitive and easy to understand. It's a concise representation of our discussion. We have the structure here, and it is not only easy to understand for us as human beings, but since it is just a directed graph, machines can also understand what we are trying to express here. So in general, what does a good knowledge representation formalism look like? Well, first, it needs to have sufficient expressive power. This means if we want to solve a specific problem and we have certain knowledge we need to represent, our formalism, of course, needs to be able to represent such knowledge. So in our case, for example, an argumentation framework is a great tool to analyze a discussion because we can, of course, model all aspects of our discussion. However, there might be situations where we have uncertain or inconsistent data. Maybe we have noisy data. Maybe we only have probabilities about some data. And in this case, we would like to have a formalism which is also able to handle these situations in a satisfactory way. The second aspect is the computational cost. So suppose you have modeled all the aspects, for example, in our discussion, and then you want to know, all right, given a certain argument, is this a reasonable argument? So can we order pizza? Yeah. And then we want this decision to be made as fast as possible. So we need an formalism which we can handle efficiently with our computers. And this is in fact the case for argumentation frameworks because this is a simple tool and we can compute solutions fairly quickly. Finally, we want our knowledge representation formalism to be well understood and easy to use. This means we want that typical research problems have been solved and questions answered. For argumentation frameworks, this is the case. There is an abundance of research about argumentation frameworks. Finally, we desire to have efficient solvers so that we can compute our solutions quite quickly. This is also the case for argumentation frameworks. There are a lot of competing solvers. All right. So, but what if we have a certain problem and we do not find an appropriate knowledge representation formalism? Well, this is where we have to propose a new one. So, once we have identified a use case with no suitable formalism, we just devise and investigate a formalism which is tailored for our needs. Then we investigate the usual formal properties. For example, like just talked about for argumentation frameworks, the computational cost. Then we have other aspects like inconsistency handling. What if there is no solution? How should our formalism behave in this situation? Is our formalism self-explanatory? Are solutions easy to understand? And finally, how does our formalism compare to other formalisms? And there are, of course, some more aspects. And then, of course, we do not only want to theorize about it, we also want to use it and test it in applications. Okay, so this was a brief overview of knowledge representation and reasoning in general, and now we are going to talk about argumentation frameworks in particular. Argumentation starts with some kind of conflicting interests, like for example in a discussion. So now suppose we have our discussion or some other kind of knowledge which is similar in spirit. Then we can perform some magic, and when our magic is done, we obtain an abstract argumentation framework representing our knowledge in a concise fashion. Once we have this argumentation framework, not only we as human beings can read it quite well, but also now machines are able to read it. Now it's the computer's turn to do the magic for us. And when he is done with it, then we get our results, which in this case is, of course, ordering pizza. And argumentation frameworks as used here in this scheme, they were proposed by Dung in his seminal 1995 paper. And you can tell already how much attention this paper received by just looking at the citation count, which is, as of recording this video, almost 5,000. For a knowledge representation paper, this is really a lot. What Dung did was abstracting away from the internal structure of arguments and just representing them as a directed graph. So Dung did not try to think about why certain arguments attack each other and what they might look like and what certain kinds of attacks you might have. He just said, all right, here's an argument, here's an attack, and that's it. That's all we care about. And this is why argumentation frameworks or abstract argumentation frameworks as proposed by Dung are a very easy to understand tool, very flexible and very powerful, and hence very popular. Now, the research is driven by the following questions and problems. First of all, we investigate the expressive power, which is pretty much what we talked about already for knowledge representation in general. We want to investigate which situations can be modeled with which kind of argumentation frameworks. Then we investigate the computational complexity. So we want to solve certain problems. First of all, assume we are given a target argument, like, for example, ordering pizza in our example. Yeah? Is there a reasonable point of view? Are there reasonable arguments supporting ordering pizza? Or is it maybe even the case that in all reasonable points of view, ordering pizza is a good idea? Well, what if there is no reasonable solution? Yeah? What can we do about this? Or maybe there are certain argumentation frameworks which are quite simple, even easier to understand than the standard argumentation frameworks. So maybe our given argumentation framework belongs to the simple class of argumentation frameworks, and then we can use even more efficient solving techniques. We have research about inconsistency handling. So assume we have an argumentation framework for a certain situation. We think we modeled everything correctly, but it does not behave in a way we want it to behave. So what is a good repair in these situations? Do repairs like this always exist? And if so, how can we compute repairs? And finally, what about explainability? Given a certain solution, is it clear why this is a solution? And let's stick with explainability here. As you can see here in our running example, it is quite easy to understand why ordering pizza has some reasonable arguments. Yeah? Because we can just say, okay, we order food. If we order food, we order either pizza or Taiwanese. And if we order pizza, we can have as much cheese as we want. Yeah, this is what we talked about. So it is fairly easy to understand and intuitive why this is a solution and why we have satisfactory arguments for ordering pizza. In our current research, we try to identify certain core arguments deciding the whole discussion. So suppose you have such a debate, and then you need to make certain choices. You need to make certain compromises between several conflicting interests. And what we try to do is we want to find these arguments you have to decide. And once you have made the decision for those arguments, then the rest is deterministic. In our example, we can say, all right, we have the choice between cooking at home here and ordering food. Now let's say we decide for cooking at home. So what happens then? Well, then we do not order food, but in particular, we do not order pizza and we do not order Taiwanese. So these arguments are out. And now we are left with the cheese argument. And since we cook at home, we can use as much cheese as we want. So everything is decided pretty much. If, on the other hand, we decide for ordering food, then we know we do not cook at home. But we are still left with the decision between ordering pizza and ordering Taiwanese, so we are not sure about the cheese argument yet. So these are the core arguments in this argumentation frameworks. Once you made a decision on these arguments, the rest of the discussion is deterministically determined. And our result is that with a simple check you can do quite easily, which is even a syntactical check, yeah, you can just examine the structure of a graph and then you can find these core arguments. So it's really simple to find these arguments, which is of course nice for us because it means that finding these arguments and trying to decide the debate in a satisfactory way is fairly easy to do. Okay, so this was the part about argumentation frameworks. Now let us briefly talk about the Living Lab demonstrator and how it illustrates our research. So recall our argumentation scheme. Starting with a discussion, we try to analyze it and obtain an argumentation framework. And this is not the main focus of our research group, which is why in the Living Lab demonstrator, it is only shown quite briefly. In this example here of the Living Lab, there is this discussion going on about the travel destination of our family. We used some arguments which are intuitive, and then we just assumed that the induced argumentation framework is given. We try to keep it simple so that it's understandable why this is the argumentation framework we obtain. Then in the next step, which is about starting from an argumentation framework, making a certain decision, we show the structure of the arguments here, which arguments we can decide, and how they interact with each other, how arguments defeat each other, and then we demonstrate the consequences of them, which in our case, in the case of the Living Lab demonstrator, is the induced travel destination. And finally, our current research about the core arguments we just saw here is incorporated already at the beginning of the demonstrator, where the user is asked whether he wants to visit a city or go to the countryside. And the argumentation framework for the demonstrator is constructed in a way where these two are the core arguments, and then the rest of the debate is determined already. All right, so this is our Living Lab demonstrator, and if you want to see it in more details, just visit us.